In the time before time, when the ancient gods of Olympus held sway over the vast realms of heaven and earth, there existed a creature of unimaginable power, terror, and tragic fate. She was not born from the minds of men, nor was she a simple figment of sailors' fearful imaginations. No, Charybdis was as real as the tides that she would come to control, a force of nature molded by divine wrath and boundless fury. Her name is Charybdis, also known to be synonymous with the most dangerous and unpredictable forces of the sea, a name whispered in dread by those who dared to navigate the perilous waters she inhabited. But before we get into today's video, don't forget to like, subscribe, and hit that notification button so you don't miss any future uploads. Now, let's get into today's video. Long before she became the terror of the seas, Charybdis was a radiant nymph, her beauty and grace as captivating as the most serene of ocean waves. She was not merely a creature of the sea but was deeply connected to it, a living embodiment of its power and mystery. Born of divine lineage, Charybdis was the daughter of Poseidon, the mighty god of the sea, and Gaia, the primordial goddess of the earth. Her lineage alone marked her as a being of great significance, one who could command the respect of both gods and mortals. Charybdis was a lover of the waters, reveling in the rhythm of the tides and the music of the waves crashing upon the shore. She danced with the currents and sang with the winds, her spirit as wild and untamed as the oceans she called her home. But beyond her love for the sea, Charybdis was also a fiercely loyal daughter, devoted to her father Poseidon, the Earthshaker, whose influence over the seas was matched only by his volatile temper. Poseidon, the lord of the seas, was a god of immense power and authority. His domain encompassed all the waters of the earth, from the vast oceans to the smallest streams. Yet, despite his dominion, Poseidon was often at odds with his brother Zeus, the king of the gods. The two brothers, though bound by blood, were frequently in conflict, their ambitions and desires often clashing with one another. Poseidon, with his deep connection to the earth and its waters, sought to expand his realm. He desired to see the seas stretch further inland, to claim more land for his watery domain. This ambition led him into numerous disputes with Zeus, who was responsible for maintaining the balance of the earth and its elements. It was in the midst of one such conflict that Poseidon called upon his daughter Charybdis, seeking her aid in his quest to expand the ocean's reach. Eager to prove her loyalty and strength, Charybdis heeded her father's call without hesitation. With her immense power, she began to draw in the waters, causing the sea to swell and surge with a ferocity that even the gods themselves had rarely witnessed. The once tranquil shores were transformed into a maelstrom of destruction as the ocean, driven by Charybdis's will, consumed everything in its path. Villages were swallowed whole, forests were drowned, and the land itself seemed to disappear beneath the rising tides. To Charybdis, this act was not one of malice, but of devotion. She was fulfilling her father's wishes, using her gifts to aid him in his divine mission. Yet, in her eagerness to appease, she failed to see the broader consequences of her actions. The balance of the earth was being upended, and the wrath of the gods would soon be upon her. High above from his throne on Mount Olympus, Zeus observed the devastation with growing anger. The king of the gods, who had vowed to maintain the order and balance of the world, could not overlook the destruction wrought by Poseidon and his daughter. Zeus was not merely the ruler of the gods, he was the embodiment of law and order, and any threat to the harmony of the world was a direct challenge to his authority. In his fury, Zeus decided that Charybdis must be punished for her role in the devastation. Though she was the daughter of a god, her actions had crossed a line that could not be ignored. Zeus decreed that Charybdis would no longer walk the earth as a nymph, free to enjoy the beauty and bounty of the sea. Instead, she would be transformed into a creature of monstrous proportions, bound to the very waters she once commanded with such ease. And so, with a flash of his divine power, Zeus struck Charybdis down, transforming her into a hideous sea monster. Her once graceful form was twisted into something grotesque and terrifying. No longer did she possess the beauty of a nymph, instead, she became a creature of the deep, her body contorted and her mouth an endless gaping maw, capable of swallowing the sea itself. Charybdis was cast into the waters of the Straits of Messina, a narrow and treacherous passage between Italy and Sicily. There she was condemned to an eternity of hunger, her monstrous form creating a whirlpool so powerful that it could suck down entire ships into the depths of the ocean. Three times a day, Charybdis would draw in the sea, her massive maw consuming everything in its path: water, fish, ships, and men. And three times a day, she would spew it all back out, only to begin the cycle again, her hunger never sated. From that moment on, the name Charybdis would strike fear into the hearts of sailors and mariners who dared to venture through the Straits of Messina. The once serene waters became a place of dread, where the very sea itself seemed to turn against those who sought to cross it. Charybdis, now a monstrous whirlpool, was the embodiment of the sea's uncontrollable and destructive nature, a reminder of the consequences of defying the gods. The whirlpool she created was not just a natural phenomenon, it was a manifestation of her curse, a never-ending cycle of consumption and regurgitation. Sailors knew that to cross the Straits of Messina was to gamble with their lives, for Charybdis could strike at any moment, pulling even the sturdiest of ships into the abyss. The once beautiful nymph had become a creature of legend, forced to be feared and respected. But the Straits of Messina held more than just the threat of Charybdis. For on the opposite side of the narrow passage lurked another terror, the monstrous Scylla. With her six ferocious heads and insatiable hunger, Scylla posed an equally deadly threat to those who dared to navigate these treacherous waters. Together, Charybdis and Scylla turned the Straits of Messina into a deadly gauntlet, where survival depended not on skill alone but on fate's cruel whims. It was said that no ship could pass through the Straits without facing certain doom. The choice was a harrowing one. Sail closer to Charybdis and risk being swallowed whole by her insatiable maw, or steer towards Scylla and face the inevitable loss of crew members to her ravenous jaws. The Straits became a symbol of the harsh and unforgiving nature of the sea, a place where even the most experienced sailors felt powerless in the face of such overwhelming danger. The legend of Charybdis grew with each passing year, her name becoming synonymous with the perils of the sea. Stories of her terrifying whirlpool spread far and wide, told by survivors who had narrowly escaped her grasp and by those who had heard the tales from others. Charybdis became a cautionary tale, a reminder that the sea was not to be taken lightly, for beneath its surface lay forces beyond human comprehension. Among the many who encountered Charybdis was the legendary hero Odysseus, the clever and resourceful king of Ithaca. His journey home from the Trojan War was fraught with challenges and dangers, but none were as terrifying as the moment he found himself trapped between the monstrous Scylla and the voracious Charybdis. Guided by the wisdom of the sorceress Circe, Odysseus knew that there was no way to avoid the danger entirely. The Straits were a passage he had to cross, but the question was how. Circe had warned him of the horrors that awaited, advising him to steer closer to Scylla, for though he would lose some of his men, his ship would remain intact. To sail too close to Charybdis, however, would mean certain death for all aboard, as the whirlpool would drag the entire vessel into the depths. Odysseus, ever the strategist, weighed his options carefully. He knew that the loss of even a few men would be a heavy burden, but it was a burden he was willing to bear if it meant saving the rest of his crew. And so, with a heavy heart, Odysseus chose to sail closer to Scylla, knowing that it was the lesser of two evils. As they sailed past the cliffs, Scylla struck with terrifying speed and precision. Her six heads darted down from the heights, each one snatching a man from Odysseus' ship before they could react. The screams of his men echoed in Odysseus' ears, their lives taken in an instant by the monstrous creature. It was a horrifying sight, one that would haunt Odysseus for the rest of his days. Yet, as painful as it was, this sacrifice had saved the rest of his crew from the far greater threat of Charybdis' deadly whirlpool. The ship sailed on, battered and bloodied, but still afloat. Odysseus knew that they had narrowly escaped the clutches of Charybdis, but the encounter left a deep scar on his soul. He had witnessed firsthand the terrifying power of the sea and the monsters that dwelled within it. The experience solidified Charybdis's place in his mind as one of the most fearsome beings he had ever encountered. However, the story of Odysseus and Charybdis did not end there. After many more trials and tribulations, Odysseus found himself once again in the perilous waters of the Straits of Messina. This time, his ship had been destroyed, and Odysseus was left clinging to a piece of wreckage as he was pulled inexorably toward the deadly whirlpool. As the currents dragged him closer and closer to Charybdis, Odysseus' quick mind raced for a solution. He knew that the odds of surviving such an encounter were slim, but he refused to give in to despair. Odysseus was a man who had faced countless dangers, and he was determined to outwit Charybdis, just as he had outwitted so many other foes. With nothing left to lose, Odysseus waited for the right moment. He knew that Charybdis inhaled the sea and everything in it three times a day, creating a powerful vortex that pulled everything into her maw. As he was drawn closer to the whirlpool, Odysseus spotted a fig tree growing from the rocks above. With a desperate burst of energy, he let go of the wreckage and lunged for the tree, grabbing hold of its branches just as the water below was sucked into the churning depths. Then he clung, suspended between life and death as Charybdis consumed the sea below him. The minutes stretched on like hours as Odysseus waited, his grip tightening on the rough bark of the tree. He knew that he could not hold on forever, but he also knew that letting go too soon would mean certain death. That's going to wrap up today's video, everyone. If you enjoyed diving into the depths of Charybdis' story, please hit the like button and subscribe to our channel. And don't forget to turn on all notifications so you won't miss any of our future adventures through myth and legend. Thanks for watching, and until next time, keep the mystery alive.